What scares me in a mutual fund today, right? So I had done this post long ago, so I'm just going to read out a lot. And so when did I start my first SIP? Maybe it was in 98, 99 or around 2000, when I met Suraj Kelly of Franklin Templeton, and he introduced me to this concept called SIP, so much so that I call him SIP Suraj. In fact, he was the person who introduced most of us to SIP, and I think the first SIP which he started was in his son's name, and I think it is still running. And so that is the SIP history that I have. So I knew about SIP in 1999, and I think it was a great concept. So yes, like many others who have benefited by this knowledge, I have also benefited by doing SIP over longish, say 30 odd years of SIP. And SIP has helped in large cap fund, mid cap fund, even in gold. People who have done SIP have benefited. But please remember, all of us, which we are talking about, all these funds which I'm talking about have, what I can say, also have survivor bias, because these are funds which have survived till today. So I guess I was lucky enough that I invested in a fund which, say, 20 years, not 30 years, so it's 20 years. We have done these SIPs, and yeah, it has worked. But there is always a worry that the BFSI overdoes a good thing and overdoes a good thing. So, for example, term insurance is a good thing, but that does not make ULIP or endowment plan a great thing, right? So maybe it is good for some people at the lowest end of society, but for somebody looking at getting an investment return, he's much better off in a mutual fund rather than in an endowment plan, right? So, educational loans, another example. I think after the introduction of educational loans, education costs have gone up. At least one sees that in US, it's not so bad in India. In case of health insurance, the minute the hospital knows that you have health insurance, they jack up the price. I mean, that is the general feeling one gets. Now, recently I've seen GIC going to court over such a matter in COVID cases, saying whenever they know that there is life insurance, medical insurance available, they jack up the rates. So now I'm asking myself, are we overdoing the SIP bit? Are we saying that too much money is coming into SIP, and therefore can the SIP harm itself? My answer is, I really don't know. It's a mixed kind of an answer. But if you talk to the fund managers, and they'll say, oh, compared to the market capitalization of the economy of the country, the amount of money that we have in mutual funds is quite small. That is true, but you don't have to look at market capitalization. You look at the top 100 companies in which all mutual funds invest, or top 200, 350 companies in which all the mutual funds invest. Compared to that market cap, are we overdoing it? I really don't know. Also, mindlessly buying the same shares which are there in his portfolio, because the fund manager is completely exhausted. He's bought 40 companies. His imagination doesn't go beyond that 40. So just keeping on buying those shares on a month-to-month basis, almost immaterial of valuation, seems to be a very seems to be a loser's game rather than a winner's game. I really don't know whether it is the best thing to do. And with the FM buying the same scripts, is there not something like, isn't he creating a confirmation bias by buying the same share at 10, then at 11, then at 12, then at 15, right? So his NAV will keep going up just because of his own buying. Is this something to worry about? I really don't know, but it scares me for sure. The other thing which scares me in a mutual fund is, if there is a very dominant CIO and he's very successful, how many of the youngsters will stand up to him and say, sir, I don't agree with you, I don't agree in this point with you? Will the young boys and girls stand up and say, it's like, you know, almost talking back to Sachin Tendulkar and saying, Sachin Tendulkar is perfectly capable of saying, look, I've been playing since the age of 16, now I'm 34. So what are you trying to tell me, right? So it's very difficult to talk to a person who's been in the market for a very long period of time, especially if you are a novice. So will you be able to stand up to a big fund manager? That is also a difficult question to answer. So first, is the SIP useful? will you make money by blindly putting into a simple set of shares? What happens to persons in the investment team who have a voice which is contrary to the CIO's voice? Is there place for such a rebel? And if yes, what is this place, right? But the other problem is when you have been buying shares, like when you are buying shares like Gillette, P&G, Bosch, MRF, Lakshmi Machine Works, the fund manager cannot get in and get out or get out of such scripts very quickly, right? That's another problem. Now you have to make an intelligent guess and see what is the market cap in which the fund finds itself, what you can buy and what you can't buy. So if you are in the mid to small cap, the question is what kind of shares will you buy and keep with you, because the minute it becomes a particular higher market cap, you have got to sell it, right? It will go from your fund to a large cap fund. What do you do in such cases? So where is all this heading? Well, you are in the top popular schemes of HDFC, your Templeton, your ICICI Prudential, etc. Then you will have to just keep putting more money and hoping that the game will stop on its own, or that the fund houses will wake up and say this much and no further. We cannot afford to take in more money simply because we have no clue where to invest it. Will we ever do it? That is the question to answer. Thank you.